Okay, good afternoon to everyone. We'll try and be efficient in time so we don't delay the next session. Good afternoon. Our panel will deal with the operational excellence as a competitive advantage, which I guess it's a mouthful after all these panels and presentations carried out throughout the day. I will just comment that we have spoken already and many have presented topics on, and I look at the plan now, environment, welfare, and crew welfare, and optimizing technical ship management and so forth, ship safety. So I think the operational excellence probably comes as the last to put everything under one umbrella. And my name is George Teriakidis, and I'm working for DNVGL, Class Society, and I'm happy to have with me here four gentlemen who are quite experienced, all of them, in their own field and companies. To my left, Mr. George Usantzopoulos, who's head of safety and vetting in Almi Tankers, a naval architect who's been in Almi around eight years, and a little bit more. Mr. Marcos Vasilikos, managing director of Eurobulk, marine engineer and studies in Newcastle and working in shipping industry since 1985 or 86. And Mr. Kouleris, he's the technical director of Prime Marine Management with a long experience. I only have to say that reading his CV, he started in shipping 2 years after I was born, so that says a lot, I guess. And Mr. Babilis, and last but not least, chief executive officer of Stealth Maritime Corporation. He's been since 2000 in Stealth and since 1990 in shipping industry. So the way we're going to proceed is that each gentleman will have a presentation putting across his points on operational excellence, and then we'll basically proceed with a couple of questions and hopefully wrapping up everything within half hour or a little bit earlier. So, George, you take the floor. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thanks, George. So, the question is, some may argue if it's of value to invest in operational excellence. You see, in a market where we're just price takers, where the freight is going to be determined by the market price and by the supply and demand, and not by the quality of the services that we provide, someone might ask if it's worth investing and how much in operational excellence. Well, we know there are many benefits, so many have been discussed from the morning in this room. You have your vessels on hire for a long time, you know your insurance costs, just to name a few of them. You have accurate financial results. You have a slight preference from the customer who knows that they can trust their cargo on your vessel. And of course, you have a peace of mind. However, I'll put the question again. Is it actually worth investing, and how much, in operational excellence? Well, in order to know if something is worth investing, you must know what it's costing you and what it's going to give you back in return. Well, my view is that you don't really need and you shouldn't go and do the math. It's just like a leap of faith. You just go there because you believe that through this way, the world will be better on the other side. Now, operational excellence has many different perspectives, and there are many different areas where you can see it. I will be focusing on only one of them, and I'll give you two reasons why. And that's the people's operations, the people element, the human element. This has also been discussed quite a lot today. And in particular, because the people operations is also a very wide range, is a very wide topic, I'll be focusing on three areas, first of which is culture, leadership, and collective participation. Now, I'll try to give you two reasons why I believe all shipping companies should be focusing to that direction, to the people's operations. This slide is from ExxonMobil. It's quite recent. And Exxon here is explaining to us that around 20 years ago, they started checking our ships with the SAR program. They checked our facilities, our equipment, the hardware, and if it's in proper condition. Over the last 10 years, since 2004, through TMSA, which has been addressed quite a lot today, they have been looking at our management systems, our procedures, our policies, and how we do things. All these things have been improving our performance with regards to incidents, and we're excelling in the health, safety, quality, and environmental performance. Now, since last year, they're explaining to us that they're going to be focusing on the human element. Now, if Exxon is pointing to that direction, then I definitely want to have a look myself. Another reason I believe the human element is so important is this statistics from BIMCO and ICS a couple of years back. You've probably come across it. It has to do with the supply and demand of seafarers. And as per these statistics, by 2025, we're going to be looking at a shortage of around 150,000 seafarers. Now, 150,000 seafarers is around 20% of the seafarers' current pool. Now, with this, when it comes to developing people, 2025, that's 8 years from now, is just around the corner. I mean, it's coming. We should already be looking at that. If I want to feel safe in an organization or put my money in an organization, it would be an organization that's really paying attention to people's operations and the human element. So for the three things I promised I'll talk to you about, culture first. Ask yourself the question, does everybody in your organization have a good understanding of your company's culture? Does everybody know? I mean, culture came up so many times today in the forum about safety culture, and it's not only safety, it's wider. So, do all the people know exactly what the values of the organization are, the beliefs of the organization? Are the behaviors of the people appropriate and as required by the culture of the company? As Peter Drucker said, culture eats strategy for breakfast. And in order not to see the negative part, I mean, what a bad culture can do to the strategy of your company, if you turn it the other way around, imagine what a proper and a good culture can do for your organization. It can make it, it's like a tidal wave. It can make it go faster in all areas. Then leadership. Now, I'm not talking just about your top guys having the leadership skills. You can train them on that. And I'm not talking about getting the good leader and putting him on top. I'm talking about defining a clear leadership model within the organization. That's something you should do. This is going to give the leaders the ability to actually know what is expected from them, and for all the followers also to know what they should expect from the leaders. And this, in combination with the culture that we're describing before, can create a great advantage for an organization. Finally, this is Marvin Wayne's book. It's called The Learning Curve. This is showing that around 100 years ago, when organizations had problems, then experts were coming in to solve the problems. Then the trend was that everybody was solving the problems within the organization. After that, 50 years back, you saw that experts were coming in to improve the systems. You had the consultants and those guys coming in to tell you how to do things. They were not coming to solve problems, but to improve your systems. And by now, all the modern companies are working in a way where everybody within the organization is going to be improving the systems. Now we're talking about the empowerment of the people, listening to everybody in the organization. This came up a lot today as well. Listen to everybody. Keep your ear up. Now, this is an 11-minute video. I strongly suggest you note down and have a look at. Invest 11 minutes to have a look. It will give you a great perspective of what I'm talking about empowering your people. It's called Greatness by David Marquette, and it talks about a commander of a nuclear submarine, Santa Fe, US submarine, who actually went towards this direction and made a difference. Strongly suggest spend some time to watch this. I'll leave you to read this slide for yourself, so thank you very much.
Thank you, George. Definitely some things to take with us. I'll invite the second participant, Mr. Vasilikos, to put his point across. Thank you.
Good afternoon. Unfortunately, Mr. Teriakidis has exposed my
age by mentioning that I have been working in shipping for over 30 years, so it is. So best industry practices. In our business, the dry sector, bulk carriers and containers, best industry practices are not mandatory, even though there is a tendency of becoming mandatory, as the previous panel has mentioned. We can draw the various practices from best industry practices, that is, from various organizations, international organizations like BIMCO, ICS, PNI clubs, or codes like ISO, SOX, Arbanis-Oxley, and of course vetting companies. Best industry practices focus on various aspects of our business, like crew and vessels safety, hygiene on board and in the office, of course, cargo and third-party property protection, environmental awareness and performance, operational health and safety, corporate governance and transparency. And of course, there are also other functions I've only mentioned, and a few of those. There are various instruments how we can measure, once of course we have applied those practices in our companies. Everybody, the top management at least, would like to monitor and measure the performance of the company and if there is an improvement. So there are various systems. One of the most widely accepted system is that of KPIs, key performance indicators. I will try to explain briefly what this system is doing. We can define various functions within our organizations, which we call specific performance indicators, and I have listed a few in that slide, which is health and safety, human resources management, environmental, navigational safety, operational, security, technical. You may expand the list as you wish, of course. For each of those specific functions, the company may define the so-called KPIs, the key performance indicators, which are measurable values that demonstrate how effectively a company is achieving its key business objectives. The list is endless, of course, but I can mention a few functions, a few indicators that the company may be interested in following up, like navigational incidents, which is collisions, groundings, budget performance, or state control performance, conditions of class imposed, carbon dioxide, emission efficiency, and the list goes on. Crew recycling rates, you can name it. KPIs may be benchmarked against the targets which are set internally by the company, or against industry averages or against other similar companies. The last is a little bit difficult because of our culture, of the culture in shipping, which does not promote cooperation between companies. So information exchange is a little bit difficult. So this last benchmarking, I don't know whether it is achievable for most of the companies. The advantages of having such systems in the company, I think I have listed a few, like the reduction of accidents, reduction of operational errors, improvement of fleet monitoring, better ship's performance and ship's utilization. These are some tangible benefits. I have also listed a few intangible benefits, like the improvement of relationship with charters, mortgagees, enhancing investors' confidence, easier and more effective environmental compliance, and easier transition to the future regulatory compliance. One may ask if all this adds value to the company and if it reduces the operational cost of the ships, because this is an issue in the very competitive environment that we are living in. I sincerely believe that this is the case. And if we properly apply best industry practices in our companies, eventually we will have some results. And I'm sure the speakers in the panel may expand on this. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Vasilikos. May I pass the podium? Please.
Good evening. Ship owners or operators are not in a position to influence the freight market. They could perhaps do this by avoiding ordering, but experience has shown that they cannot resist going to the yards when the market is high and when the prices are low. What they may do though, and this in a limited way, is to try to control the operating costs of their vessels. I'm using the expression in a limited way because the other stakeholders of the marine industry tend to have a larger say on how ships are run than they had in the past. Flag administrations, IMO, port state, charterers, terminals, insurers, NGOs, activists, lobby groups, unions vie for imposition of layers of regulation and requirements that impact on the vessel's operation and result in costs. Most of the above stakeholders are not normally required to or cannot be forced to contribute towards these costs, so there is no incentive for them to abstain from this regulatory storm that we heard before. Charterers in particular have no inclination to pay anybody a premium when they can avoid it. I always remember that in the aftermath of the Exxon Valdez and the resultant ecological catastrophe, that the owners that were quick enough to order double hull tankers enjoyed briefly a two-tier market against single hull vessels. This was short-lived, and this difference tapered off, and modern double-hull tankers got the same as older single hulls. When asked, a high-profile chartering manager, one of the big oil majors, replied that he did not feel that he had to pay even $1 more for quality. Quality had to be provided, he said, hence otherwise. And I think this attitude goes on even today. Speaking for the tanker industry, the users of each vessel have put over the years a very sophisticated and multi-layered system of appraisals of vessels and their operators. In an age of information sharing and transparency, the means at the ship user's disposal to manage their risk, as is now the catchword, is awesome. And whoever aspires to do business with them has to go along. It should be added that they are not happy with parties that go only for compliance, just to satisfy the requirements. They are looking for true believers, for companies that are proactive, not reactive. And their vast experience ensures that they know who is who. Having said that, we have come to the conclusion that it is up to the individual shipping company to adopt a strategy of best industry practices that will enable the particular company to compete for business in this environment. The alternative would be to try and operate in fringe markets where lower standards are acceptable. But even there, high quality tonnage presents itself when no other business is available, and they can elbow low quality tonnage very easily, as West Africa is one example, where although it was a depository of very old and substandard tonnage, when there was no business elsewhere, new buildings would go straight from the yards to West Africa. Usually the challenge for those responsible for running of the vessels is to convince the money men that adopting best industry practices and their entailing costs make sense and enhances competitiveness. Not an easy task, especially in poor markets. Another thing that we have come to realize is that it is not possible to implement piecemeal best industry practices. They are necessary in all aspects of ship management. Spending in one sector and starving another sector will not have very positive results. For tankers, and we heard before there was a difference of opinion about whether bulkers or tankers should be considered in a different light, that dry cargo does not have the tasks, the risks as a tanker. Of course, tankers are much more complex, and they can create huge problems from pollution, etc. But if one compares the loss of life from marine accidents between the tankers and the dry bulkers, dry cargo vessels and bulkers over a number of years, the loss of life of seamen is heavily caused by bulkers and by tankers. So, I mean, we are all for clean seas and birds that are not covered in oil, but what about loss of life? I think that all sectors of shipping should have high standards. I mean, it's not possible to. Now, I can speak only for tanker management, because we do not have in our company, we do not have any dry cargo vessels. So our guidelines for the sector we are in is the TMSA, the Tanker Management Self-Audit System. And the latest version, which is the TMSA 3, is more or less renders the previous version obsolete. The best industry, apart from this TMSA best industry practices may also emanate from various industry bodies and organizations mentioned previously, but also can be established by individual companies in accordance with their vision and what they want to achieve. Of course, the dry cargo has the has other guidelines, but TMSA I think is quite a useful guideline where you all other sectors can also pick and choose, as we said before. Intertanko, ISBOT for gas carriers are also sources where one can get some inspiration, so to speak. Now, the BIPs can be categorized in many aspects of ship management. For example, the TMSA 3 has 13 subjects, whereas the previous TMSA had 12. Cyber security has been added here before. Now, the BIPs, the best industry practices, will not result in the lowest possible OPEXs in absolute terms, or even over a 12-month period, and may even show a different picture between a new ship, which is below 5 years old, or an older ship that is over 10 years old. These are two different animals, and they need most probably a different approach. But over a longer period, the savings and therefore competitiveness becomes more evident. And also it is coupled with access to business that would be otherwise denied to lower standard operators. Vessel users want to transport their cargoes as cheaply as possible and trouble-free. If they had any interest in the technical challenges, they would be in shipping too. But they're too smart for that, most probably. So they believe that even in the most difficult of times, that there are best industry practices that are forced upon the ship operators if they want to be in a particular game. But also, the company itself can choose between these and do the best it can with the resources it has. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Pouliaris, for the interesting points. And Mr. Babilis.
Good afternoon. I have the privilege to to wrap up, let's say, a little bit. We are in the last session. So I wish to focus on two issues mentioned in the previous panels. One dear colleague said in the previous panel that safety is a journey, and I agree to that. In the same manner, excellence is a journey. excellence is not a plateau that we reach and we stop over there. It's a continuous effort for improvement. The second issue that was touched during this day is the importance of the crew, the personnel well-being, the culture, and all these related things. So this also has to do with the operational excellence, because according to my view, there are two folds, one on the individual basis and one on the corporate level. On the individual basis, the individual is striving for excellence at work, and if the individual, the crew or the office employee or whoever strives for excellence, he gets a sense of self-fulfillment. And this leads to job satisfaction from the quality of work that has been achieved. In this way, the morale of the people is increased and leads back to more quality of work. And then we end in a virtuous circle of personal satisfaction, job performance and efficiency. Similarly, on a corporate level, having employees striving for excellence, provided that the systems and the philosophy and the culture of the corporation is the correct one, will benefit even more, because the final excellence will not be the summary of the individual excellence, but it will be multiplied by the company's culture and the company's structure. In this way, adopting the best industry practices protects the company from regulatory breaches, improves company's image in a more transparent environment, provides legal leverage, and finally, comfort to existing and prospective clients, suppliers, subcontractors, and service providers. In addition, and combining this with my previous comment, it attracts high-quality candidates for employment who share similar values, leading to another virtuous circle. Finally, quantifying the benefits of operational excellence into financial results or competitive advantage, I think it's a little bit tricky. It is not a straightforward task, because in most cases, the benefits are hidden under lost opportunities due to the lack of adoption of best industry practices and operational excellence. And these lost opportunities, in many cases, are not easily identifiable. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Papilis, and all gentlemen for your input. We are pressed in time, so I'll just take the lead and just have one question, and maybe one of you or some of you would like to comment. Now, we all heard about culture, crew, people. How this is a journey, you cannot basically achieve it just like that, the operational excellence. I would just, coming from the class society as well, I'm thinking about other stakeholders in the maritime industry beyond the vetting and charters, which are important to you. Do you think that with all the actions that you're implementing within your companies, in your operations, in the office, with the crew, in terms of safety, and which all lead to operational excellence, that they are actually recognized by everybody in the maritime industry, or that there is a need of people simply saying, that people look simply on compliance and don't look on the extra things that are actually carrying out independently? Like, anyone to take a comment on that? Yes?
There is not a simple answer to that. Obviously, there are some market participants which appreciate the application of best industry practices and quality of their partner, of their business partner. Charters, I think, are one of those partners who appreciate quality, even though, as we've said before, their prime objective is price, but to establish long-term relationships with charters, they need to have confidence in the organization, and this can only be achieved by the application of PPIs. Other organizations may not appreciate the quality as much. I can mention class societies, for example. if I may, but I think they do not have such a culture, or they have not managed to pass such culture to their clients. The underwriters is another interesting area, insurance underwriters, who I think do appreciate by indirectly by looking at better loss records of the company.
Fair enough, yes, of course.
Yes, the underwriters usually put a premium on quality. They, when their loss ratio is positive, when they make money from you, and because the insurance industry is soft for many years, then good quality owners that have a very good record can press them for a lower premium, which leads to competitiveness, because the insurance part of the OPEX is quite important. But they are one of the few that appreciate
all this effort. I see. Mr. Babilis, you want to add something?
I also agree. The picture is a little bit gray. There are areas that quality shipping is appreciated, as the example of insurance, and there are other areas that it is claimed that it is appreciated, could be appreciated at a point, but not significantly. And as said earlier about the market freight rates and so on, if it was in an ideal world that it would be appreciated, then reading the freight rates, we would see two or three different cases. We could see high quality tonnage, medium quality tonnage, and low quality tonnage rates. But I haven't seen any kind of categorization like that. You may see for vessels of this age, that age, and the other age, but not about the quality, the actual quality.
Yes.
So I don't believe that actually quality is appreciated by the market to the extent, at least, that it is claimed to be appreciated. Thank you.
Yes, please, George, the last comment. Thank you.
So, thank you. Well, yeah, I agree with everybody who commented on that. I'd just like to add, just from a different perspective, if we went 20 years back, we would see that the quality departments did not even exist in the old major companies. And I'm talking about the tanker industry because this is where I'm coming from. Nowadays, at least they have the option to give the green light or the red light to a vessel before it's being chartered. So they will show a preference to quality operators. So I wouldn't be surprised if in 10 or 15 years from now, we actually start seeing some premium for the high quality operators, which is something everybody, I believe, should be striving for.
Okay, thank you very much. So I think we'll have to wrap it up here. We've seen that basically all of your companies and many others are doing quite a lot in order to achieve an operational excellence and show this to their customers. And as mentioned, some other stakeholders, like class societies, probably should take a look into that and award it one way or the other, which I agree, actually. So I would like to thank you, gentlemen, for taking the time preparing and giving your views to me and everyone. So we'll wrap it up here. Thank you very much.